What's good, everybody? Jordan here, the FitCon. Today's video is going to be the fallacy of jacked inmates in prison. I know you, like myself, have probably seen 100 movies where they look inside prison and there's guys in the weight yard and the weight pit hitting the free weights, looking jacked, swole as fuck. And yeah, that's what I thought going in. And I had buddies while I was in there that are like, hey, tell me about these guys in there. Are they all jacked and huge? And when I went in, I was 250 pounds. I was prepping for a bodybuilding show, my first one actually at that point in 2010. And eating a lot of food and going from that to remand, which you would call jail, to prison within a few weeks. I was caught up right before a trial, so I went basically rushed right into prison, luckily enough, because remand slash jail is horrible. It totally sucks. To prison. And when I showed up there, I was on a lockdown. Somebody had just gotten assaulted or stabbed, something like that. It's a very frequent occurrence in most prisons. And I sat in a cell for a few days with literally nothing. Not a damn thing. And you do get fed 3 meals a day. And those 3 meals are dictated basically by Health Canada, who decides what the average Canadian male should, or if you're a female in prison, what a female should consume throughout the day. I had written numerous complaints about the amount of food we were getting and was told that Health Canada dictates what we deserve to get as an inmate, which worked out to be about 2,600 calories a day for the average guy. The difference being, you know, there's guys in there that are about 100 pounds or less, and then there's guys in there that are 300 pounds. So a guy like myself who's 250 pounds, you're going to get the same amount of food as a guy who's 110 pounds. And they don't care whether you're muscle or fat. You know, a 300-pound guy who's fat is going to get the same amount of food as a 100-pound guy who's skinny trying to get big. So, and the food there basically is shit. There's no way of really sugarcoating it. You get a tray. You get a little slop of meat or a meat alternative now that they've kind of strayed away from having straight meat. Some burnt out, steamed out vegetables where there's not a lot of nutrient density left in them. And then a lot of carbs, heavy carbs. A couple pieces of bread with every meal. That's kind of what you use to fill up. For me, I didn't really touch the bread because I just, that's not a thing for me. So to get enough food, what do? Well, you're in there basically. You know, you do see guys that are jacked and in shape. And while I was in there, I kind of maintained a certain body weight. And to do that, you basically gotta hustle to survive in there. And to survive and hustle, there's guys that do it for money or to get high or do drugs or whatever. And then there's guys who do it just to get enough protein to survive and maintain their muscle mass. And that's how sad it is. You can spend a little bit of money on canteen every week, but you only are allowed to spend so much per year. I think it's about 700 bucks, which doesn't really go too far. Your paychecks, which work out to, you know, a few dollars a week, go in there. But when you're buying protein powder for a few dollars a pack, it doesn't really go too far. So to hustle in there, guys basically survive by, there's guys that work in the kitchen. They'll smuggle meat out and sell it for a high price to people that have cash to pay for it, usually drugs of some sort. And there's guys that will sell you their canteen, their transfers for the year. So you can send them money and they'll transfer it in and you can kind of buy things from there. There's a few ways people do it. But in order to basically eat well, you're almost forced to, you know, do what you're not supposed to do in there, which makes it kind of contradictory when you're trying to behave yourself and get out, but you can't, you know, can't survive what they're feeding you, and you got to basically supplement yourself to stay unhungry throughout the day. So you're definitely not going to see guys gaining weight, gaining muscle, unless you come in on a flyer and you're all strung out on drugs and you get off the drugs and you start working out, then maybe you'll gain some weight. Especially nowadays, considering they've taken out mostly all of the free weights in Canada due to the fact that certain inmates, not usually the ones that use weights to train, will use the weights as a weapon, right? You know, the second last jail I was in, they used the Olympic barbells to smash a wall in a riot through healthcare to get into the drugs and the narcotics that healthcare had, right? So they eliminated free weights there and put in a bunch of plated machines, and you're lucky to even get those. when I was in the max, there was literally no free weights. And we barely had access to the gym because every time we did, somebody was getting lit up in there. And we, you know, barely even get in there. So you're training in your cell with body weight. And if you're lucky, get some garbage bags from the cleaner, fill them up with water, tie them off. Three bags is usually enough. Put them inside of a t-shirt, get a broomstick. You get 3, 4, 5, 6 bags like that, and you can have a pretty decent workout with these water bags until the guards come by, pop them, and then your cell's flooded with water. So they don't like that either. They don't want you to be too strong. They just kind of want you to wither away or kind of hang out until you get kicked out. They don't want you getting too strong, too defiant, anything like that. So to stay in shape and conditioned was hard. But for me, it became more of a psychological thing, right? I trained to maintain my sanity. I was taking personal training courses through correspondence and training people, cellmates and other guys in the prison. And then also people I had outside of the jail, I was sending programs out to. So I was lucky to have that. And I was lucky to be able to maintain kind of the weight I had. And it was great for me because I never really dabbled in calisthenics until I went to prison and then realized, you know, I'm sitting on a couple hundred pounds of free weight right here. And, you know, basically when you realize that, you know, there was basically no limits as to what you could do. You start doing upside down push-ups, pistol squats, partner assisted squats, you know, conditioning basically on the fly. You're in a 6x10 cell. You can't really go too far, especially in the max. We did get a little bit of yard time where you have access to the dip and pull up bars. And even that's questionable because you go out in there and you never really know what's going to pop off in the yard. So you always got to basically stay on point, stay kind of ready, stay conditioned. And that's kind of what we did in there. You're just maintaining. You're trying to survive. You're in an environment where not everyone's going to survive. The weak definitely don't. They get taken advantage of. It's, you know, unfortunate. And if you're looking at going to prison, you know, it's going to be kind of a wake-up call, especially for somebody like myself who's used to having a fairly privileged life, I guess you could say. Going from that to literally having nothing, you really get to know who you are and what you're made of. And it's definitely a wake-up call. For me, it was the best thing that ever happened. But for some people, it ruins them, right? And for some people, they get caught up in the system and it just becomes the rest of their life, right? So it's unfortunate, but that's kind of just the way it is. So, the fallacy of getting huge in prison, it's not really a thing. Maybe minimum security, you get access to actual free weights. The last prison I was in, I was minimum security when I got kicked out. And we had a little good weight pit in there, lots of free weights. I was able to pack on, you know, a couple pounds and then some, which was great. But the other security levels, the medium and the max, you know, at that point, you're just in a survival state. And for what you're getting fed on, which is basically between $5 and $6 a day, I believe, depending on what security level you're on, you're not going to get any kind of high quality food for a few bucks a day. So if you're going to try and eat well, you got to kind of figure it out on your own. And that's the shitty part. So to each their own. And stay tuned for the next one. Basically, I'm going to keep unloading all this info on you. This shirt's from Murder Mia. You know, I'm not trying to glorify crime in general. I'm just saying if you're going to do the crime, do your own time. That's about it, right? I learned my lesson the hard way. Not everybody needs to go that path. But if you're going to be doing the crime, you should be doing the time. Tattletaling on your buddies is not the way to go. So Omer Demia, great shirts, great clothing line. Love it. And positive message here. Everybody, avoid going to prison so you do not have to wither away. And you don't have to take your quality of living away. If you want to train, you want to work out, going to jail is not the way to do it. And it's not going to be, you know, what is going to be the path for you. You get in there, you get caught up in the wrong scene, and it's basically the end of anything good going on. So anyway, stay tuned and we'll talk.